coming to sing? Huh? You coming to sing? That's fine. We're good.
Brother, we've met to worship. Let's do the other side right there. Have a great day, Art. listen to the words that the author wrote in this last verse of this song.
When Christ shall come,
if you would. He is the lily of the valley.
Thank you.
thank God for his spirit tonight that I felt already. I look forward to in the preaching tonight. You pray for our pastor tonight. Pray for him all the time. He and his family, they need our prayers. We need each other's prayers tonight.
Thank you, choir, for your singing tonight. I tell you, I think the songs that were those that requested those songs, both songs were really good that they requested. But I also thank the Lord because, you know, it's His presence that makes the difference. You know, if the Lord wasn't real, we'd get nothing out of this, okay? But the Lord's real tonight. He's still in the saving business. He's still in the helping business. He's here, and I'm very thankful to say that tonight. I can remember starting out. I've shared this many times. Starting out and preaching, going to different places, going to churches that I didn't know anybody there. Somebody'd get my number and they'd call, and I went. And some places you could feel the presence of God, and some places you just couldn't. I'm thankful we're in a place tonight we can feel the presence of God. And you know, the presence of God is a comfort and a peace that only He can give. And people that don't know the Lord and that are not saved, I honestly believe once they get a dose of the Holy Spirit, get a dose of God, you know, they'll just keep coming back. But we're going to share with you some scripture tonight. Stand for a moment. Turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 4. Ecclesiastes chapter 4. And I must admit to you tonight that while I was, you know, had this scripture in my heart, read it sometime a while back, and began to read and study and pray, and the Lord began to speak to my heart and lay things on there, I got some stuff out of it I really wasn't expecting, and I thank the Lord for that. So Ecclesiastes chapter 4, we're going to cover tonight. It's a popular, I guess, topic. You've heard, you may have heard many preachers preach on it. You may have heard this saying before that somebody may say this. They may quote it in the service. They'll say a threefold cord is not easily broken. Kind of like this morning's message about the hedge. Stand in the gap and make up the hedge. You know, that's a very quoted verse or saying, and may not know where it comes from. But tonight, Ecclesiastes chapter 4 and verses 9 through 12. Verses 9 through 12. It says, two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him. Again, if two lie together, then they have heat. But how can one be warm alone? And if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, tonight we come to you in prayer tonight, thanking you, Lord, for just this wonderful time that you've given us, Lord, tonight. Thank you for your sweet Holy Spirit, God. Thank you, God, for the songs of praise that we sung tonight. Thank you, God, for the encouragement, Lord, that we get. Thank you, Lord, for these children and those that have participated here tonight in the choir and in the services tonight. We thank you for each and every one. God, we are such a blessed church and blessed people tonight. God, there's not enough time in the day that we could sit down and count all our blessings and have time to express gratitude towards those blessings and prayers that's been answered and all the things that you've done. Lord, as we pray tonight, God, we just pray, God, for this service. We pray for each and every one that's here. We pray for those that are not here tonight, God. Lord, there are many needs in people's lives today, even in our own community, even in our own families. the places we work, the places we go, the schools, in the classroom, the teachers, the children, God, everyone has needs. Lord, as we pray tonight, we just pray that you would help us tonight with the words. Help us, God, give us the things you'd have us to share, the things that you'd want us to use and say. And Lord, just help change every one of us here tonight. And God, will give you all the thanks and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tonight, as we look in the scripture tonight, we read to you verses 9 through 12. And like I said in the opening, verses 12, the last part of that is a quoted verse that I've heard people teach on. I've heard preachers preach on. I've heard people mention this when maybe a person or a family may be going through something, and these words are given to bring encouragement. Also, these verses are often used in wedding ceremonies. I've been to several weddings where the minister will he'll bring these verses and he'll use them in a marriage ceremony, and using those to signify the joining of a wife and husband. And they will use the significance of the third part of using it to bring in God into the marriage, into the relationship. Also, there's many people I've heard people you talk about the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, and bring that into that fold. But as we look tonight in the verses, we're not going to use any of those tonight, so we're not going to preach on marriage. We're not going to preach on the Trinity, but I believe in all of those. But we're going to preach tonight on some thoughts that's given here about relationships. And, you know, one of the things about relationships is that is a design by God. Say, preacher, how do you know that? Turn with me to Genesis chapter 2, and let's read one verse tonight. Genesis chapter 2. I had it marked, and I think I accidentally pulled a paper clip out and shoved it somewhere else to mark another spot. But Genesis chapter 2 and verse 18, and notice what the Lord God said. It said, "And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him." You said, preacher, you weren't going to preach on marriage. Well, I'm not going to preach on marriage tonight, but notice what the Lord said. He said, it is not good for the man to be alone. So in the design, God designed for man to have a helpmeet, and that being his wife. But in particular, the thoughts we want to use tonight is never be alone. And so as we look in the scripture tonight, you know, when Solomon, he was a very smart man. He was a man that had great wisdom and great knowledge. If you have a chance and you want to read some things that about Solomon, read in Proverbs and read in Ecclesiastes some of the things that he put there. But notice what he says in verse 9. He gives an illustration here. He says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. Now, just think about that for just a moment as we look into the scriptures. Now, we said that we used an illustration where God said it's not good for a man to be alone. Now, when you think about how that God, you know what, you think about your
just a little one to come and request such a song. That lifted me up. It stirred in me tonight. And you know what? I'm glad that in my life and in my church and even in my family, God has surrounded some lifters, brothers and sisters, tonight. And you know what? I've got friends all across this county. And you know, if I ever needed help, ever needed them to pray, I could call on them tonight. And you know what they would do? They'd get down in prayer. And I honestly believe they'd pray for me. And you know what we do tonight? As a church tonight, God's called us to be lifters. Amen. And I'm glad there's times, you know, we say, preacher, what do people need? Sometimes they need lifted up. Notice in Galatians chapter 6, and notice what it says. Hey, this is a good chapter to read. It says, brethren. And you know what that means? That means born again believers. He's speaking to the church. If a man be overtaken in a fault, he said, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. And I like this part right here. It says, bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. And when you think about that for a moment, say, preacher, how does that describe two things? First of all, every one of us is capable of falling. Every one of us is capable of sin and doing something wrong. Have you ever said something you wish you could take back? Hey, that's my prayer every day, amen. Have you ever been in a place you wish you'd never gotten into? Been there, done that? Have you ever done something that you've truly regretted? I've been there. I've done that. Have you ever made bad decisions? I'm not talking. You know, sometimes you've got decisions that may be life-threatening or even decisions, you know what, that don't have much consequences, but you regretted them. Hey, we're all capable of doing such things. And notice the Bible says, it says that we which are spiritual, notice he said restore. And you know what, I'm glad tonight, knowing that as a child of God, if I get out of his will, or if I get on the run, you know what he's going to do? He's going to come hunting for me. Amen. Because I'm one of the sheep. The shepherd knows each and every sheep that belong to him. And he said in a parable, he'd leave the 99 to go after that one. You know, sometimes we become that one. And I'm glad that God sends his son out for me. Notice this. Listen, we described lifters. And I believe we've ascribed some of those that have fallen. And you know what? Tonight, there's a third person. And you say, preacher, who is that? It is those that are alone. And now notice this. And you say, preacher, you said it was about relationships. Yes, it is. I believe tonight that there's many types of relationships. You've got marital relationships between the man and the woman, the husband and the bride. You've got relationships between parents and children. You've got relationships between grandparents and grandchildren. You know what you saw tonight? These little ones up here. You've got cousins up here. They got relationships one with another. You've got relationships in school. Those that teach, those that do things with school, you've got relationships with your students. You know what? When you think about that, they're very important in that. And notice this. It said this. It says that if thou fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But notice the second part. It said, but woe to him that is is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him up. You say, preacher, we need to pray for those that are fallen. Absolutely, tonight. You say, preacher, we need to pray for those that are lifting. Just keep lifting. Absolutely. But we got to pray for those that are alone because they don't have what we have. They don't have a friend in Jesus. They don't have a church member that they can rely on. They don't have somebody that they can turn to. And you know what? Today, there's times that we all need help. Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful. I've not ever been on a big boat, not a huge boat, but I can remember a long time ago when we got we went down to Louisiana, to New Orleans, when I was probably 13, 14 years old, wasn't very old. The Tennessee, the Vols went to the Sugar Bowl, and Dad said, let's go. So we went, and we get down there, and Mama, she wanted to ride one of those great big steamboats, okay? And you know what? When we went, I guess it's a bay there. I don't remember much about it. But we get out there, we get to the boat, and you know what? The waves were huge, and they were splashing around. You know what the first thing was that caught my eye? It was that life preserver on the side of the ship. And you know what? It had a rope attached to it. And you know what I was thinking about? You know what? I grew up on water. I grew up in a boat. And I know what a life preserver is. It's to prevent you from going down. But I was thinking about that big old boat. Being out in big waves. And all I could see is that life preserver, that ring, that circle with a rope. Somebody throwing it out to me when I needed help. And you say, preacher, what do we do when we're praying for those that are alone? We're throwing out the life preserver. Or we're trying to get Jesus closer. Have you ever seen in movies where they throw that thing out and they don't throw it out far enough? What they do is they'll pull that thing in as fast as they can and try to get it closer. And you know what? I'm thankful for those that reach out and try to get a hold. You know what? There's been times in my life. You know what? God sent his life preserver. That's Jesus, amen, to rescue me. I'm glad I reached out. I'm glad that he knew where I was at. But you know what? There's been times in my life since I've been saved. You know what? That nobody knew anything about. But God laid me on somebody's heart to start praying. And you know what the church was doing? You know what family's doing? They're throwing out that life preserver. Look at this and notice the Bible says, and it says, again, if two lie together, then they have heat. But how can one be warm alone? You know what, tonight? I am never alone. I've got somebody with me every time that I've ever been someplace physically without my wife or my family. You know what? I've been into Mexico several times by myself. You know what? It's a scary thing. Being in a foreign country. Hey, I can't speak Spanish. I can't speak anything. Being there and not being able to speak the language. And you're fully dependent on somebody that can interpret what you're saying. But you know what I discovered? I wasn't alone. The Lord didn't go with me. But Jesus was with me. Amen. You say, preacher, did you pack him in your suitcase? I done that one Sunday night. You know what? I took him home with me that night after service. But notice this. The Bible says, and if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him. Now, I want you to think about that for a moment. You know what? We, at times, the devil will try to prevail against us. Life, the world, sin, it tries its best to prevail against us. You know what it's like this? You got to be careful. You got to tell people to be careful when they dabble in sin. Because the first time, it may not bite you. The second time, it may not bite you. But the third or fourth time, it may grab a hold of you and not let verse the Bible said this, and it said, if one prevail. I was thinking about, I always think about Moses when the children of Israel was in a battle. And you know what the Bible says? When he held his arms up, they were winning. But when his arms got tired and began to sag down, you know what happened? The enemy began to prevail. And say, preacher, what happened? God, you know, say, I think about it this way. Moses was alone. But thank God, he sent him somebody that could help him. Somebody that could have stayed his arms up. And you know what? When you think about that tonight, do we not have the comforter that Jesus sent? You know, he told many times that he was going to have to go away. He said, but he was going to send the comforter. And you know what? In my Bible, the comforter is capitalized with a capital C. That is a person tonight. That is the Spirit of God. And that is God sent for you and I. Now notice this. The Bible says, he said, and two shall withstand him. And a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Now what I'm getting to is this. If one... Now listen, I know people do things all the time by themselves, and great accomplishments have been accomplished by just one person. But you know what? Today we've got the church. We've got each other to lean on. And you know what? I'm thankful tonight that not only do we have each other, but we've got Christ. We've got Jesus. Amen. He's never lost a battle. He's never lost a war. Everybody likes undefeated teams. You know, every year, and it's going to come up again this year, they're talking about who can go undefeated in the NFL. And you know what? Every year, they get disappointed. Somebody gets close, and they always mess up, and it breaks a lot of people's hearts. But we're serving the Lord today that's undefeated. Everybody wants to have a win team. Everybody, when a ball team gets hot, you say, preacher, what happens? Everybody jumps on board. It's like the balls in the baseball team. You know what? I'll be honest, I jumped on board, amen, because they give me something to get excited about. But when it comes to Jesus, I was already on board because amen. He's never lost a battle. You was thinking about this. When in verse 11, the key part of that verse is being together. Notice that. The key to that verse is being together. Guess what? We all have something in common. Say, preacher, we're flesh and blood. Nope, a little deeper than that. Say, preacher, we're all here gathered together in the church. Nope, it's a little deeper than that. We've got the same blood flowing through our bodies. We've got the same Jesus that, you know what, that worked in our hearts, that can work in others. The key part of that is being together. And notice this. And he said, and if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him. You know what? Whenever the enemy is trying to defeat us, whenever the enemy is trying to win, and that if we just resist, the second one comes along and it will help us to win. It'll help us to withstand him. I was thinking about this. Notice, you say, preacher, what do these verses teach us tonight? If we can take anything away from these verses tonight, it is this. It teaches us to have the right relationships and to never be alone. You know, I heard somebody say a long time ago, I don't even know who said it. I've not quoted this in a long time, but an idle mind is the devil's playground. Amen. And that is the truth tonight. I was thinking about King David. David was a great king, but you know, when I was reading over there about his life and when he committed sin and when he looked upon Bathsheba, you know the problem with David? He was alone.
Never be alone. And you say, preacher, you've got Jesus. You can be alone. Yes, Jesus is always with us. But it's always better to have a brother Christian, a Christian brother or a Christian sister with us. It's good to be in church. Amen. I don't know about you. I didn't like preaching. I love Chris, but he got a little old, okay? I did. Me and Chris had a good time. Me and Mike had a good time when we was in here preaching, just us. But there's nothing like fellowship. There's nothing like being close together. And you know what? I know we've got some church tonight that they can't be here. They're taking care of loved ones, or they're sick themselves, or they're shut in. Say, preacher, what do you do for them? You lift them up to the Lord.
Amen.
You know what? They've got Jesus just like you and I. And he can bring that same comfort.
Amen.
You know, I gave you that example about that life preserver being on that ship. I don't know what you call that big old round thing, but
every movie, especially if it does something with a boat or sea, somebody gets thrown overboard, somebody falls in the deep, and somebody reaches up and they grab that life preserver and they take that thing out and throw it out there. And it's to get to them quickly. You know,
a few times, and I appreciate the job they do. It aggravates me sometimes, but I do appreciate the job they do. But one of the requirements, if you're out on the waters in the state of Tennessee, one of the requirements, you're to have a throw cushion. And not only, you say, preacher, what's a throw cushion? It's not a life jacket. It's a cushion or a floating device that you can throw to someone that's in need. And the last two times the TWRA's come by my boat while I've been fishing, guess what he's looked for? Say, he's looking for your license. And he gets to that later. The first thing he looks for, he's looking in that boat for that throw cushion. I said, I know exactly where it's at. It's in that bin right there. He said, yeah, but it would make me feel better if you get it out and get it a little bit closer when you get to it. You know, I want Jesus that close. And you know what? People around us today, we talk about it in discipleship training tonight. I didn't talk, I know a lot less than everybody else talked. The devil has blinded so many people. The devil has convinced so many people that God's not real. He's convinced so many people that they can live in their sin and that they'll be all right. He's convinced so many people that it ain't worth going to church. He's convinced so many people that, you know what, you're all right where you're at. But that is contradictory. That goes against what we preach. We need Jesus as close as we can get. We need fellowship. You know, God designed us to have fellowship.
Amen.
That was his purpose when he designed man. So that God can have fellowship with man and man fellowship with him. I'm thankful for that tonight. Brother Bob, would you come get us a song? Relationships. I have to be honest. Been a lot of relationships in my life I've messed up. Been a lot of relationships in my life that's probably not been the best. And you know who I have found that helps the most when you need help in relationships? Is the Lord Jesus. You know, I'm thankful tonight, first of all, that we can stand tonight and say that our church is a lifter. We lift people up. We help people. But you know, there's a lot of things out in the world and a lot of people out in the world, they're pushers. Say, preacher, what's a pusher? You know, when somebody gets down, they just keep pushing them down. I like lifters. Amen. I'm thankful tonight for you, church. You know, I've got confidence in my church that when I need lifted up, you know where I'm coming? I'm coming to you. I'm calling you and you. I'm calling everyone. I know and I trust that you lift me up to the Lord. I know if I do wrong, somebody's going to straighten me out. Say, preacher, God will do that. Yeah, he will. I believe me in this church. If I done something wrong, we'll grab a hold of me and say, hey, look, we need to talk about something. I'm thankful for that tonight. We need to be accountable. You know, in my notes, I wasn't going to touch on this, but God's laid it on my heart. I wrote responsible down, and then I crossed through it. First thought was like, oh, don't sound right.
But you know, when I read in Galatians chapter 6, we are responsible to help and to lift people. And you know what? You know what I have found the most? When you help someone, guess what that person does? They help someone else. Then guess what that person does? They help the next person and the next person. It just continues to flow out. It's kind of like a kid. You remember going to a pond and throwing a big old, hey, I didn't like throwing them little rocks. I wanted to grab them big ones. Is that big around? I wanted to make the biggest splash. Wanted to make the biggest wave. And you know what? When that first rock went in, it created a wave that traveled all the way across that pond. So that wave will travel until it hits something. Let's stand tonight. Maybe there's someone in your family, maybe there's someone in your life, maybe there's someone God's led on your heart tonight. You need to lift them up. You say, preacher, how do I do that? Starts in your heart, ends in prayer. Starts in your heart, and it ends with prayer. Brother Bobby. 's been good to be here tonight. It's good to be in His presence. Thankful for what He's done for us and thankful for all that He's going to do for us. Please don't forget, this coming Sunday will be Mother's Day. I'm looking forward to a good service with the Lord. So, you know, invite somebody with you. You know, you may have somebody in your family that don't go to church, hadn't been in a while. Give them a call, invite them. Mother's Day. God'll meet them. God'll help them. And so you pray one for another this week. Don't forget business meeting Wednesday night. And I ask Brother Mac McCain if he dismisses in prayer, please.
Lord, we just want to thank you for the day. Thank you for the message we heard today. Lord, most of all, we want to thank you for that sweet Holy Spirit you just sent down on us. And Lord, the ones that don't have that, Lord, we just pray that they'll come to know that. That's where you get it. And Lord, we just had you go with us this week. Watch over us and take care of us. Be it all those we know it's sick and having problems. These things we ask.